So in this video, we're going to be talking about Alexander the Great, or what's so great about Alexander. So Alexander comes to power very young as the son of Philip. And Philip has accomplished more than any other Macedonian king. He has defeated both the very troublesome barbarian nations to the north and taken direct or indirect control over most of the Greek world through a combination of very limited warfare and much more in the way of very clever political machination and insinuation. More to the point, at home, Philip is so powerful because he has developed these personal relationships with the tribal chiefs who, you know, he drank under the table, who he caroused with and hunted with and built up these personal bonds with. This is in the nature of the Macedonian kingdom, and this was a particular quality of Philip. Philip was very much a man's man. Philip was very much a Macedonian. Philip was very much, you know, a proud barbarian in many ways. As much as he looked toward the advancement of Macedon and and doing so through, you know, Hellenization, through increased trade and commerce and cultural interaction and patronage of Greek art and you know, poetry and all this, you know, Philip himself was very obviously to everyone who looked at him, you know, a man who got drunk, who loved women, lived a bawdy and rough life that the tribal chieftains could respect and identify with. Alexander, his son, is another story. Alexander, his son, is someone who is Greek educated and who is, who is, instead of being handsome, is beautiful, who is possessed of immense charisma, but in a way entirely unlike his father. And so this, in combination with coming to the throne at a very young age, means that, to compare to Philip, to all that he, the immense amount of things that he accomplished militarily, politically, socially, personally, the personal bonds he had, Alexander is more than, any other ruler that you could name is in a deep need to prove himself. And so and the interesting thing is that so much about Alexander that has come down to us is about image, is about the idea of Alexander that is sold about him to from a very young age. Philip, and especially Alexander's mother, Olympias, is engaged from Alexander's childhood in building him up as distinctive and unusual, as more than ordinary, and the stories that are told about him in biographies, some of them are developed later, some of them are spread at the time. The most famous of these being that, you know, he was able to tame at a very young age the untamable horse, which became his horse, Bucephalus. And so forth and so on. Alexander is very much about an image, and the trick, therefore, is A, to perpetuate that image, and B, live up to it. And Alexander spends his life doing this. And so it's quite appropriate and apt that much of what we have about Alexander is imagery and sort of the message and the story and the propaganda, you might almost say. This mosaic from Pompeii is one of the better known images that's at least to a certain extent contemporary. Most of the actual images that we have come from later and represent you know, sort of the mystique of Alexander. And so, you know, here we have a coin that is, you know, closer to contemporary, but it presents Alexander as a kind of Heracles character. Heracles is always identified as wearing, you know, the lion's head and skin, and here's Alexander being presented in the same way. You know, but the descriptions of Alexander, either in words or stone or marble or mosaic, always dwell on his beauty and on the fact that, you know, in addition to or in spite of being so beautiful, he is brilliant and fearless, that he is not merely sending his men into war, but leading them, that he is more than an ordinary man. And in this way, you know, for the Macedonians, they can sense for the first time there's something a little bit alien about Alexander because he's so Greek, but he can embody the actual Greek ideal in a way that makes his Macedonians, you know, not just to, you know, loyal to him, but admire him as something more than them, as sort of like, you know, a next generation, the evolution of Macedon here in the flesh as their own king, their own brilliant, you know, leader shining like the sun. The glory radiating from his appearance, from his actions, from his energy, from his dynamic, from his willingness and, in the end, capability of conquering the greatest power in the world, the Persian Empire, conquering Asia and bringing, you know, almost all of civilization under his sword. And so, you know, all of the presence of him is there as a you know, as a Macedonian boy, as a royal noble of this land of horses, and all sorts of un-Greek exploits. That has been, you know, that has been shaped into something, something, you know, profound and new, and therefore provocative and compelling. It starts with his Greek tutelage under Aristotle, and continues on through his life. And Alexander believes in the Greek ideal. You know, he. You know, he studies, you know, not just you know, the essential elements of Greek, you know, education, you know, the musikai and Homer and Hesiod and so forth, but he actually believes in the Greek ideal, and even to the point of taking an erotic protege. Hephaestion, who is his, you know, his companion, his lover, but also, you know, the person to whom, you know, he commits, you know, the, you know, his future experiences. And so there's a tragedy that develops later when Hephaestion dies before him, and this causes Alexander a great deal of pain about his own legacy. And so Alexander takes on what Philip was not able to do because he died prematurely. He is able to take on the invasion of the Persian Empire, and he's able to do this, you know, in part because of what Philip had already accomplished, not only in stabilizing the Aegean world, but also in reinventing the warfare, reinventing the phalanx, reinventing the ways in which the hoplite army fights, and an additional corps that can be added to the you know, to the hoplites, you know, use of additional kinds of weaponry, including archers and so forth and so on. And so the ability of Macedon to enter into this, and then, you know, on top of this, we have a great deal of tactical skill on Alexander's part, and also a good deal of luck. There's also the fact that Persia is not actually terribly well equipped to deal with an invasion. One of the things about the Persian Empire is that it had learned from the previous failures of empires that had gone before it not to be oppressive. The trick to developing a successful and durable empire is for the people that you rule over to not mind being ruled over. If you oppress them too much, their identity and culture and heritage is in danger, and they fight back. If you try to wipe out their identity, they fight for it. But if you rule over them pacifically, if you extract from them the minimum in tribute and service, and cultivate positive relationships with the subject peoples, then you tend to develop a strong and stable empire, because people get the benefits of empire. People get the benefits of a higher standard of living throughout the empire, access to natural goods and manufactured goods throughout the empire that would not be available locally, and so forth and so on. And so the Persians, as a result, don't have a large standing army occupying their provinces, their satrapies, because they don't need to. And to have a large standing army would be counterproductive. It would provoke their subjects. And so the Persians don't have large numbers of soldiers, especially in the outlying provinces. Most of the Persian frontiers are at natural boundaries. The Indus in the east, the Caucasus and deserts in the north, the Sahara in the southwest, and the Arabian Peninsula in the south. The only place that they're really bordering on potentially troublesome people is the Aegean, and the things had evened out with the peoples of the Aegean, and so the Greeks had fought themselves into exhaustion during the 4th century crisis. They hadn't really reckoned on Macedonia rising up as being such a great power so quickly. And so Alexander is able to charge into Persia. He's able to fight a few important value battles at Granicus and Issus very early on that wipe away a lot of the initial hostile forces that they might have faced, and then takes a strategic step of taking care of the sea bases, so that they can't be attacked from behind by water, establishes control over Egypt, which isn't a great deal because Egypt was only loosely attached to the Persian Empire, and then, only then, marches into Persia itself to take on Darius III and successfully march into Babylon as the king of Asia once the Persian armies and Darius are defeated. And so this is all, in some ways, there's a combination, in other words, of what Philip had done, what Alexander had at his disposal in talent, and the fact of how the Persian Empire is organized. But the real thing about this is that almost from the beginning, Alexander's goal in the East isn't simply about conquest. He doesn't take on the throne in Babylon as a Macedonian king ruling over conquered territory as a Macedonian emperor. What he's interested in is cultural synthesis. What he's interested in is, Alexander knows that the Greeks are the most sophisticated civilization, and he admires them and embraces the Greek idea of advancing as individuals and as a culture toward the ideal. So he embraces the Greek idea, but he also knows that in Mesopotamia are the most ancient and most developed civilizations, the richest cultures that have ever been. And that Babylon is the oldest and most cultured city in the world. And so, the one thing about the Greeks is they've always known that they came along late. That the Greek world is new compared to the thousands of years that Babylon and Egypt had already been around. And so what Alexander wants to do is to create the ultimate culture by synthesizing, by merging together these two great cultures into the ultimate culture. Everything that he does is not simply about conquest, not simply about territory. It's about bringing about mega culture that is more advanced than the Mesopotamian, more advanced than the Greek, brings more of a benefit to the people that live under it than for any other culture. And so, when people say, well, Alexander conquered all these places, but then, he died very young and his empire falls apart into pieces. This is not what this is about. The actual legacy of Alexander persists for centuries. And even more than this, the Greek world is united under this new unified culture, which we call the Hellenistic world. And this is what dominates how people live in the Eastern Mediterranean, for centuries afterwards, even after the Romans come. The Romans come to the Hellenistic world and they learn Greek and they start to imbibe this culture because it is greater even than their own, as much as they are, as much as they hate to know this, the Romans are the first to admit that what Alexander accomplished was the bringing together of what was indeed the ultimate culture. And we'll see how that plays out politically and culturally as we continue. But for now, that's that.